Hello and welcome to another episode of the TheSynapse e-learning program. With us today we have Dr. Andrew Agius, a general practitioner with special interest in chronic pain management, who has agreed to be with us here today to speak about medical cannabis from a medical point of view. Dr. Agius, thank you for being with us here today. On to my first question, from a neurophysiological point of view, how does medical cannabis affect the brain, and is it pharmacologically different from cannabis used for other purposes?
Mm-hmm. So to understand how cannabis works on the brain, we need to understand that we have what is known as an endocannabinoid system, which is an extensive system of receptors located throughout the body, and which is more abundant than all the other neurotransmitter receptors put together, making it one of the most important physiological systems in our body. Now, the role of the endocannabinoid system is to maintain homeostasis or balance at a cellular level, which means that when there are abnormalities in certain neurotransmitters, or there is, for example, metabolic abnormality, the role of the endocannabinoid system is to restore normal levels of the abnormal neurotransmitters or chemicals in the body. So this means that the endocannabinoid system is involved in many disease states and many illnesses. And that is why cannabis can be used extensively for many different kinds of conditions, especially immune-mediated conditions such as autoimmune disorders, inflammatory conditions such as arthritis and rheumatological conditions, as well as conditions manifested by abnormalities in neurotransmitter levels such as depression, anxiety, and other psychiatric disorders.
From a pharmacological point of view, though, is medical cannabis different from other forms?
Well, cannabis is one type of medicine. It can be available in different forms, but the difference between its medicinal use and its recreational use, it's mainly the dose in which it's given, the mode of delivery, and also the intention with which it is taken or administered. For example, we know that commonly recreational use of cannabis can be in the form of, for example, smoking a joint or eating a space cake, while medicinal use would be more responsible administering of the medicine in doses which are less psychoactive and cause less side effects, and which are prescribed in a way to produce a therapeutic effect.
Sometimes in certain social circles, medical cannabis is regarded as a cure, as a panacea for all ailments. Do you agree with this statement?
Well, it is definitely not a cure for everything, but because of the extensive endocannabinoid system in the body, it could be a possibility to help with many different kinds of conditions, which, like we said, where there is mostly an abnormality in either neurotransmitter function, because cannabinoids, the function of them is to restore balance and to bring everything to normal functioning. So it can be used, for example, in depression and anxiety, where there is an abnormality in certain neurotransmitters like dopamine, serotonin. It can be used in Parkinson's, where there is an abnormality in dopamine, Alzheimer's, where there is acetylcholine problems. And
the list goes on.
And also, very interestingly, there is some research showing that it can be used in cases of cancer, which this has been tested in animals, and it's not just to control the symptoms associated with cancer, such as pain, nausea, but also to actually have an effect on controlling cancer growth and even killing cancer cells. Now, like we said, we cannot generalize. Obviously, there are certain cannabinoids which can be used in certain cases, and sometimes if they are used wrongly, they can cause the opposite effect. So we must be very responsible and base what we prescribe on what research and evidence is available in order to get the right effect, obviously.
Doctor, I also understand that a tenery mucosal spray containing a cannabinoid has been accepted for Maltese patients with multiple sclerosis and will soon be made available. And the discussion is also ongoing with regards to the introduction of other forms of medical cannabis. What are your comments about this public discussion, first of all?
At the moment, maybe it's good to say the way the law stands. The law, which was issued in 2015, states that specialists working in the specialty of neurology, psychiatry, oncology, or anesthesia can prescribe a medicinal preparation of cannabis when clinically indicated. And this law was implemented at the end of last year, 2016, where Sativex, which is this oral mucosal spray, was accepted as a medicinal preparation which can be prescribed. Unfortunately, the exporter of Sativex does not want to export to Malta, so for the time being, we cannot actually have this medicine available for our patients.
Just for commercial reasons, so right now.
Exactly. Also, this Sativex is just one type of cannabis preparation, because it's got a ratio of THC to CBD 1:1. At this point, it's good to perhaps say that the two most common therapeutic agents in cannabis are THC and CBD. They both have different therapeutic effects and can be used for different conditions. And what we actually look for in a preparation is the ratio of THC to CBD, because, for example, conditions needing high THC would be, for example, like nausea, weight disorders, pain sometimes, and conditions requiring a higher CBD perhaps would include, for example, epilepsy, and there are various anxiety. When we look for a medicinal preparation, we need to see the difference in the ratios. Now, since Sativex is a ratio of 1:1, it limits our therapeutic effects. So what we would need ideally would be a range of preparations which would have different ratios of THC to CBD, which can be used obviously to treat a much wider range of conditions. Now, in Holland, they have what is known as Bedrocan, which is a range of cannabis strains. They have about 6 strains, and these are in the form of dried buds. So they are actually the actual flower, dried, and they are vaporized in approved medical devices, where the plant material is heated to a certain temperature, and depending on the temperature that it is heated to, it provides different therapeutic effects as well. And the patient inhales the vapors, and this produces immediate relief for whatever the patient is treating. Now, the proposal was that we get this medicine to Malta as well in the form of dried buds, and it has been accepted by the Medicines Authority and also by the Superintendent of Public Health, and hopefully we will soon have this preparation available in our local pharmacies to be able to treat our patients.
Understandably, all this information is of great importance in a clinical context, as you're alluding to, the multiple uses of cannabis. Mm-hmm. And also, understandably, patients have access to the internet and they may sometimes have misguided opinions about how medical cannabis can be used. From your own professional background, what advice can you give to general practitioners and to all physicians who come in contact with patients and have to discuss medical cannabis? What pitfalls should one avoid?
Well, I mean, I think the most important thing is to be well educated. The doctor needs to know very well what is the function of the endocannabinoid system and how a patient can improve or augment this endocannabinoid system, which is responsible for many of the body's functions. And it is not just through cannabinoids that we can boost this endocannabinoid system, but also through other means. For example, we once thought that the runner's high which is the feeling of euphoria experienced after a person does some exercise, was manifested by endorphins, when in actual fact, that feeling of euphoria is the body's endogenous cannabinoid anandamide acting on the CB1 receptors in the brain, producing an effect similar to when a person smokes a joint. So this is something obviously where we see that the body's natural endocannabinoids can actually boost the endocannabinoid system and make a person healthier, because whether a person gets sick, how quickly a person heals, whether a person develops disease or not, these are all factors which depend on endocannabinoid tone. So what I experience from seeing patients with chronic pain, most of the patients that I see seem to have gone through a period of very intense stress, or either it was prolonged or else it happened like a psychological trauma early in life, where what happens is when they're traumatized, when they go through, for example, I don't know, the death of a child, for example, or something similar, they get a certain damage in the endocannabinoid system, and this later on in life can cause a condition where there is endocannabinoid dysfunction or deficiency. Conditions such as fibromyalgia, migraines, IBS, where for the time being there is no real effective treatment, because we try to treat these patients with anti-epileptics, with tricyclic antidepressants sometimes, and patients are not always satisfied with the way their condition is controlled. And recent research is showing that cannabinoids are much more effective to treat these patients, because the actual problem is an endocannabinoid deficiency. So if you replace the endogenous cannabinoids that are deficient, you will produce a state of health and you will restore the body's natural function.
Understandably, as you already said, medical professionals should keep themselves updated. Can you advise any resources which one should consult when trying to update himself on such a burning topic?
Mm. Well, there are quite a few reliable resources, but my personal favorites are projectcbd.org, which has a lot of important text and videos and also research articles. There is the IACM, the International Association of Cannabis Medicine, which is also packed with the latest research and evidence that is showing what cannabis can actually do. And my personal favorite is learngreenflower.com, where this company in California gathers all the experts in America and also from all over the world and produces these educational videos. And these videos are very educational, and they can provide the professional who perhaps doesn't have enough knowledge with enough education to be able to guide patients properly.
Thank you, Doctor, for your time. We hope that this interview has helped to further your knowledge on medical cannabis from our point of view, from a professional point of view, and we invite you to share this video with your professional colleagues. Thank you.